Greetings, my fellow YouTubers. Challenger here in St. Louis, Missouri, once again. And I was just wanting to keep you updated on the Cobra 2000 situation I have here. Any good news, unfortunately. As of now, you know, as of a while, as of a few minutes, a few hours, a few days, the Cobra 2000 has been retired for a long time, I guess. Because, being that for the near future and for the far future, I can see that the station will be using various sizes of RF amplifiers, both during the day and at night. The Cobra 2000 does not like the high RF fields. And there are some high RF fields from some of the larger amps. The little ones, well, they put out an RF field because they're just, you know, a little small and they're very shielded. And they're inexpensive, so, you know, they're not going to put all that much shielding in them. And they're used to be in a car, so nobody complains when you're driving down the highway at 80 miles an hour and you're talking on your little RF box and all of a sudden somebody's garage door opens. What are you going to do about that? You know, I mean, just keep on cruising while they shake their fist at you. I'll get you with all them antennas, my pretty. But, so, you know, the little ones, I use the low power. I use about 70 watts at night, starting about 11 o'clock, 10 o'clock sometimes, but about 10 o'clock. I use about low power, 70 watts, 100 watts. But during the day, I shift over to one of my tube amps, and I'll go about 350. And I don't do it to talk skip. I don't talk skip. I've had many, many comments on my channel and lots of invitations to talk skip and to talk with various people in, for instance, the UK and Ontario, Canada, and Alberta, Canada, and a few stations in South Africa. They advised me that there are several frequencies there that we could communicate with no problem. Well, it may be so. But communications over there on those frequencies are a lot different than they are over here. A lot more crowded over here. At night, there's not much happening. Even on the other channels, you know, it's mostly dead except for 19. The Skipland comes in every now and then, of course. Mostly 19 again. And it just tears that channel apart, man. I mean, unless you got some serious wattage, you're not going to do nothing on 19 here in the United States. 19 goes nuts during the day, and sometimes at night when the skip comes in, you can't talk. Not unless they're close by, you got some serious power, or that you want to talk skip. You know, I mean, Denver comes in, shaky ground over Southern California comes in. All these guys, Bassmaster was coming in the other day. He was spanking, but it's not my thing. I did that thing 25 years ago. You know, I'm not into skip land anymore. It's fine. It's good. It's good stuff. I mean, it's fun to do. It helps you gain experience in long-distance communications. And it's fun to know you can communicate with somebody using a little walkie-talkie and a piece of ground wire and some wet spaghetti hung out of your window. Nevertheless, the Cobra 2000, it might be the combination of the Cobra 2000 and the Shure microphone. I've never had that problem before. Boy, that's a good looking mic, isn't it? And it's got weight to it, man. It's heavy. The only problem is that there is no shielding in this thing. I mean, there's some shielding here around the magnetic transducer, and there's a cup here made out of some metal. and the shield is soldered to that, and it goes down here, which wraps around the white wire, of course. Goes in there, but for the most part, there's no shielding to it. There's no shielding here. There's a steel base, but it's not really shielding. Beautiful microphone. I can't say enough about Shure microphones, of course. But in the high RF levels, you know, I guess they don't have Shure microphones in high RF levels. They're found in police departments, fire departments, paging activities, and in those applications, they're not using. They might use 100 watts, but its transmitters are far away. They're in the repeater building. They got remote control instead of high RF levels in your immediate area. You know, they got the console and they got the microphone connected to your console, and then the console's connected by remote control to the transmitter, which is in a completely different part of the building, or even in a different building where the tower is, and you've got all your RF cavities, your multiplexers, your diplexers, duplexers, coax, all that good stuff. So those microphones really don't see a lot of RF levels of that high level. So it could be the problem. And at this moment, I'm trying to procure one of those little adapters that will allow me to take this microphone. No. This microphone, which is a 4-pin Sedelta ME3 Echo Master Plus. Woo! Wee! And it's got a 4-pin plug. What I want to do is, I don't want to desolder the thing because, man, that's a hassle and a half. I hate it. So what I want to do is unplug it. And use one of these. So you get your 4-pin. Now what this adapter here is, it takes your 4-pin plug and turns it into the 5-pin DIN connector, which everybody and their brother and sister and mother and father and uncles and aunts, they hate that connector. The 5-pin DIN plug is the most horrible connector in the world. Except for maybe the N. And the N, they tell me that it's really easy to wire up. I've tried to wire it up 5 times, and I pretty much gave up. Because, you know, I just don't have the patience. So what I'm looking to do is, instead of having this go from the 4-wire to the 5-pin DIN, I'll have it go from the 4-wire to the 5-pin Cobra. You got the 4-pin Cobra, or Uniden, or Galaxy, to the 5-pin Cobra 2000. That way I won't have to wire this and mess up my good thing. And this is a lifesaver. So, that's the situation. Until I have a way of trying a different microphone on the Cobra 2000 while I'm using higher RF levels in the area, I have to do it will be retired. It served me for 32 years, served me well, never gave me a problem, have never given me a problem except for blown light bulbs. So... And it's got the meters. I mean, they're dead. But it's 32 years old, and I don't look at the meters. It's got the SWR meter. I don't care. I've got SWR meters out the wazoo, if you will. I've got the watt meters. I don't need to know what that thing, because it's inaccurate anyway. So there's no problem with actually having it off the air right now. I don't know when it'll come back on the air. If it will, man, I might just retire it forever. I'd like to talk on it again, though, because really, there's no match. This radio here comes close, though. Comes very, very close. As a matter of fact, it may be the new base here at the Challenger radio station. Let me show you what my radio base looks like since the Cobra 2000 came out of line. Let me just let you give you an overview of my station right now. This is the station. From this side, of course, big watt meter, the station monitor. This is a Silver Streak 200. I give it 14 volts and it outputs 70 watts because that's all it's going to do. It'll never do 200 watts. You can give it the maximum 16 volts, and it will never do 200. It's got two MRF 455s in it, transistors. They're not hydrocodones. They're not Tylenols. I only have this because it was hot down here. Oh! There you go. A little bit of an arc right there. We'll turn that down. Turn that off for now. Did you hear it? Pow! Little blue arc. That ain't good. So we're fine. We got a little bit of a ground right here just in case. The Cobra 2000 does not like to be grounded. Don't ask me why. Stupid. We got this coming up here. The red wire comes up to the ground bus bar, which is connected by a 6-gauge copper, solid copper, that runs outside to two copper ground rods, 10 feet into the ground. That's what that does. So it works, and it works well. It works very well for being a small one. I run this during the nighttime, and it runs good. Sounds good. But this is what's doing main duty right now. Let me sit down here. You get a better shot. The Realistic Navajo Sideband Base Station. This radio, I have not modified. I bought it used from a friend of mine in the other state next to us, Illinois. There's a radio shop over there. I bought it at a fantastically beautiful price. It didn't even come with a stock mic. And I don't know if it's been modified because I've never been in it. But it is consistently over-modulating the truckers as they come through here. They consistently tell me to turn it down. They have requested I turn down the modulation on this radio. The modulation is virtually off. There's a little hole in the back of that thing. And it's almost off. Now you can turn the ALC and there's no diode or resistor to clip. As far as I know, there is two VRs, variable resistors, to turn up if you want to adjust the modulation. I don't know if that's been done, but the modulation is consistently overwhelmingly loud, and it's a good sounding radio. Hear that skip ram? Let's see what we can do. Break one now. Anybody got a cabbie? Yeah, how's the modulation on this old radio? Come in. I appreciate that, Gravedigger. Trying to make sure my little old radio's working. Thank you, sir. Have a good day. And that's what it does. As you can see over here, as I key the mic, let me see if I can get a closer shot and hold the camera a little bit more steady. Yep. That's about 70 watts. Oh, yeah. Now that's what I'm talking about. Normally I use the bigger one. I haven't switched over from last night. I'm still using the small one right now. But the Sedelta. The Sedelta Echo Max Plus ME3 has a little knob right there. And that's your Echo. Of course, I don't use the Echo. I try to turn it off as far as I can. But you can turn it all the way off, and you still have a very small hint of echo. Which is okay. Nobody complains about it. It kind of enhances the situation with the truckers. As well as the world-famous Range Plus that I use during the nighttime. Because it does get dead. There's some stations that are way in Illinois that I use the Range Plus to help me listen to them. It's a wonderful, wonderful piece of equipment, and I thank you so much out there for allowing me to have that. That is just, I can't say enough about that little piece of equipment as it goes. Come in. Fantastic little piece of equipment. And that's not the speaker that you're hearing that through. That's the speaker up there you're hearing it through. And they can get loud. So that's what's going on so far about that. Been having some major problems here. I don't think you've ever seen this. This will become a video soon. If I could just get a forklift to help me show it to you. This is my Gonset GSB201 linear amplifier. This is not CB class. That's not something you'd find in the backyard or in your back pocket. I have to use a forklift to pick that thing up, and it runs. You have to key it up at minimum with 80 watts, and it will key down with no problem, and I'll put about 800 watts. So one of these days we'll take a look at that. I'll take the cover off and we'll look at the complement, the full complement of 811s. Four 811s. And they light up like Christmas lights. They look like light bulbs, 100 watt light bulbs when they lit up. They are beautiful to check out. And the other ones we'll be checking out later on when I can borrow that forklift is the Hammerlin HT37 transmitter. That thing weighs a ton. And the HQ140X from Hammerlin.
This is not a Hammerlin. That's a Hallicrafters. What a dork.
This is a Hammerlin. HQ-140X. And the one below it is the 129X. HF tube type rigs that weigh a ton. But they're meant to be. Meant to be heavy and big time. And this thing looks kind of cute, but there's nothing in it. It's just a case. It's a case of mistaken identity. There's nothing in it. So that's what's going on with the Cobra 2000 and the various pieces of equipment over here. The entire station, because of the Cobra 2000, is a complete mess. Normally I have all my equipment here. You use it. It's at your fingertips. Knobs, plugs, switches, handguns, but nothing of the sort right now.